and welcome to Wide Angle this week. Today we're in conversation with Ramachandra Guha, historian, author, provocateur. He makes us think about people in India's past and how we should be looking at them, their lessons for a modern India. We're here to talk about his new book, which is Gandhi, the Years That Changed the World between 1914 and 1948. What were the struggles that Mahatma Gandhi faced in those years as he led the freedom struggle against the British? Thanks a lot for being with us on the show. I want to actually start by diving straight into what I feel is the real meaty part of the book, which is the conversations and the tensions, perhaps, between Mahatma Gandhi and Dr. Ambedkar over the issue of untouchability. The abolishing of untouchability, clearly a common agenda for both, but very different approaches. To me, as I was reading it, some of those conversations clearly reflect conversations we're having today as well in the country.
So, I mean, it's in many ways the most important debate that Gandhi undertakes. I mean, Gandhi has many debates with major political figures, with Jinnah about the whole question of whether India can be a united country or Muslims need a separate homeland, with people like Bhagat Singh on the use of violence, with Tagore on nationalism versus internationalism. So Gandhi is a compulsive debater. And in many ways, the most moving, resonant, complicated and contemporary of those debates is with Ambedkar. And there's asymmetry because Ambedkar is much younger. He is born in a Dalit house, Gandhi's upper caste. Gandhi is already a colossal public figure known as the Mahatma when Ambedkar enters public life. And it takes great courage and character to challenge someone of that stature. But at the same time, Gandhi is open to the challenge. He's listening. And I think Gandhi starts as someone who opposes untouchability, but thinks caste per se may not be such a bad idea. That division of labor according to professions, a hereditary division of labor, it's been there and it need not be hierarchical. You know, it can be vertical rather than horizontal, but, you know, maybe family professions are fine. And then he slowly moves towards taking a more critical approach to caste. And Ambedkar plays a central role. Of course, Ambedkar is not the only one. I talk in my book about the great Malayali reformer Narayana Guru.
Yes,
who first advocated temple entry and persuaded Gandhi to take up temple entry.
Also, Rajaji has conversations.
Rajaji also within the Congress. But essentially, it's a debate between an upper caste reformer who wants to cleanse Hinduism of the taint of untouchability through shaming his fellow Hindus, through feeling guilty himself. And on the other side, a Dalit activist who struggles for self-respect, dignity, you know, and is much more combative and strident in his criticisms of the caste system. And I think both change their positions. And it is, as I said, it's a debate of great historical interest and with contemporary resonances as well.
Right. So the reason I brought it up before we go into other aspects of the book is because today, we are in a situation where Ramdas Athavale has actually challenged government notification on not using the word Dalit for scheduled castes and instead saying scheduled castes. And the terminology of the caste, the depressed classes versus the Harijans versus the scheduled caste, was also a conversation Gandhi and Ambedkar had. And the allocation of power on the basis of their caste status was what ultimately also brought them together and created conflict between the two. So taking those conversations into account, how can we apply those to what is happening today on the issue of the nomenclature?
You know, Maya, it's important to see it historically. And it's important to see the struggle of oppressed people as it evolves over a period of time.
Right.
And there's an interesting comparison between the struggles of women for gender equality and the struggles of untouchables for caste equality. All right. Now, if you look at, to begin with, you have a few broad-minded men who bring women into public life. That's the first stage.
Right.
The second stage is that women take ownership of their own struggle. They don't need upper caste. They don't need men to patronize or encourage or indulge them. Right. And something similar is happening in the history of the struggle for full equality for Dalits. That maybe in the early 20th century, they needed people like Gandhi to awaken the conscience of the majority of Hindus. But Ambedkar comes along and owns the struggle. And after Ambedkar's death, it is the Dalit struggle. In fact, Dalit is a term proudly avowed by Dalits, by people of the former untouchable caste. It's a term that connotes, of course, their oppression, but also their great desire to overcome that oppression through struggle. Mm. Now, in Gandhi's own lifetime, he used different words. He started by speaking of suppressed classes. Okay. Now, I don't know why he gave that up, because that's very clear and direct. He says these are suppressed. Then he adopted the term Harijan, which had a sort of patronizing air to it. And he started the Harijan Sevak Sangh, which was supposed to do social welfare for the... And Rajaji, who was one of his most far-sighted and acute colleagues and disciples, said, he said, the aim is not service but abolition. Mm. Call it Abolition of Untouchability League. Don't call it Harijan Sevak Sangh. And in retrospect, that was perhaps a mistake that Gandhi did not adopt that name. I mean, normally he was very alert and acute about the symbolism of names. And I think today, it's like no one uses the term Negro anymore.
Correct.
Negro went from black to African American. And here you went from depressed classes to Harijans to Dalits. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the term they want to use for themselves. And I think it mystifies me as to why, you know, the government would issue an advisory, and that also to the media. Mm. It's rather strange. Yeah. And I think it'll be counterproductive, because I think Dalits want to be known as Dalits, just as African Americans don't want to be known even as blacks or as, you know, because African American gives them ownership of America. It doesn't say you've come from outside. It doesn't stigmatize them in a certain way. So I think people must be, you know, especially oppressed people, must be allowed to use the term they want. Hmm. Tribals want to be called Adivasis. They don't want to be called scheduled tribes, right? Hmm. Because it gives them a certain self-respect. We are the original inhabitants of this land, right?
They also derive agency from the names they choose to give themselves.
Absolutely. And in this case, I mean, there's been a transition over... it was depressed classes, mm-hmm. then Gandhi brought in Harijans, then the constitution brought in scheduled castes. Mm. And then in the 1970s, after Dalit Panther movement, Dalit became came into popular currency, first in Maharashtra, yeah. and then all across India, mm-hmm. used both by Dalits and by non-Dalits. And Dalit is the term that is, that I think most Dalits themselves would avow. And so it is rather strange that the government wants to deny them this.
So coming back to the book, it's very interesting. This relationship and this dynamic is very interesting because there is somebody of that time fighting their own struggle, engaging with the British independently, in a sense, of Gandhi as well.
Yeah.
And challenging the very man who's seen as the one who's held the freedom movement together, yeah. irrespective of individual, personal, even ideological differences that other followers who became leaders, as you put it, might have had. So it does two things. One is it shows that the challenge to Gandhi, apart from what came from the Mahasabha and people like that, came from someone who was younger, who was clearly yeah. of a different bent of mind. But did he welcome that challenge? Because he didn't seem to encourage it from amongst the other leaders.
Well, I think he had to confront it. And over a period of time, he saw the power and the potency of that challenge. He saw that it struck at the very heart of the freedom movement. Hmm. That the legitimacy of the struggle for independence was called into question when it was so evident that a large section of Indians were themselves unfree, made unfree by other Indians. Mm-hmm. So I think to Gandhi's credit, he recognized the force of Ambedkar's challenge. He took it aboard. He responded to it in his own way by moving from attacking untouchability to advocating interdining, intermarriage, to organizing All India campaign, traveling across India to shame his fellow Hindus into acknowledging this terrible sin that they'd inflicted. Mm. The terms he uses, I mean, he says untouchability is a form of Dyerism. It's like General Dyer. I mean, yeah. Hindus can be like General Dyer, right? Because they're slowly killing, maybe not through guns, but through oppression and stigmatization. They're slowly killing and depriving these peoples of humanity. So I think, to Gandhi's credit, he takes Ambedkar's challenge very seriously. He modifies his views. He becomes more and more radical himself. He abandons the struggle for freedom at critical moments to focus rather on social reform and social equality. And of course, as independence approaches, There is a historic compact where Ambedkar joins the Congress and becomes the law minister.
Right.
So it's a very moving story, and I think I've tried to tell it in a way in which you can see the dilemmas both men face. And I think it's a story that brings honor and nobility to both. I mean, you can say obviously Ambedkar's struggle is harder because of the position of disadvantage, because he's younger, he's challenging an established, a colossal figure in the national imagination. But to Gandhi's credit, he recognized the force of Ambedkar's challenge, which no one else in the Congress does, except for Rajaji. I mean, Nehru, Patel, Bose, all the great Congress leaders are obsessed with gaining freedom. Young Congress activists have gone to jail, tell Gandhi, we went to jail for political independence, why are you diverting us by talking about this untouchability stuff, right? So very few people in the Congress party recognized what Ambedkar was saying, that, you know, it was Ambedkar was striking a very blow at the legitimacy of the freedom movement.
So was it a diversion in Gandhi's mind?
No, because it was central. He saw it was not a diversion. Mm. For him, he recognized that Indians could not justifiably, honorably claim political freedom when they were denying freedom to such a large section of their own people.
Mm.
Right. So likewise, Indians could not justifiably, honorably claim freedom when Hindus and Muslims were fighting with one another.
Mm.
So I think interreligious harmony and the abolition of untouchability in Gandhi's eyes were absolutely as important as Swaraj or political freedom. And I think in that he was very unusual.
And also extremely unequivocal about it.
Yes,
I mean,
yes,
he was
yeah.
clearly about
absolutely.
This nature of equality. But you make another very interesting point, which is that while Ambedkar sought to do this through the state and through political change, Gandhi sought to do it through trying to raise the conscience of the communities around him. Was that a successful endeavor?
Well, it was only partially successful. Because, as I said, in his lifetime, he was unable to get a large number of upper caste Hindus to recognize the force of Ambedkar's challenge.
Mm.
And after he died, the Gandhian movement abandoned the anti-untouchability campaign. I mean, that's not a part of my book, because my book ends with his death. But one of the reasons that the struggle for Dalit emancipation has so long and so arduous is that while the Dalits have Ambedkar as their inspiration and exemplar, upper caste Hindus have forgotten Gandhi's message.
Mm.
You know, they have relapsed into complacence, denial, into a kind of scapegoating of reservation and all kinds of other things, right? So the fact that in ending, I mean, again, there's a very important parallel with the feminist movement. You know,
mm.
feminism will succeed when men themselves recognize, how much they are responsible for the inequality within the family, you know, whether it be the household, child rearing, all kinds of other things, right? So I think upper caste Hindus after Gandhi, including Gandhians themselves, I don't mention in the book, but I mention elsewhere, that the most important Gandhian social reformer after his death, Vinoba Bhave, never organized a campaign against untouchability. Likewise, with, you know, maybe even JP and some of the others, right? So I think that battle has to keep on, and in many ways Gandhians after Gandhi have betrayed him in this respect.
Not just Gandhians after Gandhi and the fact that social reformers did not pick this up. I think, just, you know, going by what I've read and my understanding of those times and the history, this also became a cornerstone, apart from him wanting Hindu-Muslim unity. This became another reason for the Hindu right at the time to start opposing Gandhi as well. So, did they conflate the anti-untouchability movement with the communal harmony movement?
Not really. I mean, the Hindu right in the 20s and 30s defended untouchability because they say it's encoded in the scriptures and it's part of our tradition and our civilization. Slowly and reluctantly, they recognized that it was a abhorrent practice that brought no credit to Hinduism.
Mm.
So by the 40s, I think even the Hindu right could not defend untouchability. You're right. And of course now, on the question of Hindu-Muslim harmony, they remained at odds with Gandhi. And they remain at odds with Gandhi today as well. I mean, that is really at the heart of Gandhi's last year, when partition was inevitable, partition occurred, there was an exchange of populations, there was communal violence in Pakistan against Hindus and Sikhs, there was communal violence in India against Muslims, and Gandhi said, I'm going to put a stop to this. And the last months of his life are in some ways the most heroic. I mean, the fasts in Calcutta and then in Delhi. And had he not been murdered, he was going to go to Pakistan to fight for the rights of minorities there. And on that, of course, on the question of untouchability, the Hindu organizations have reluctantly but inevitably accepted that it can't be defended. Mm. But on the question of religious pluralism, there remains a large gulf between their view and Gandhi's view. In Gandhi's view, India is not a Hindu country. I mean, his first speech to the Congress Party after independence to the AICC in November 1947, he says, this country does not belong to Hindus alone. It belongs to Christians and Sikhs and Muslims. And I expect every freedom fighter to recognize this as we go forward. So I think those perspectives are irreconcilable. I mean, Gandhi would be absolutely opposed to the definition now being promoted of India as a Hindu state or Hindu civilization. He would have been appalled by, I mean, he would have been, in fact, disgusted by the claim that Hindus will be a Vishwa Guru to the world. I mean, he would say, look at your own deficiencies. Who are you to teach the world about, you know, how to run affairs? Mm. So I think on that, clearly, there is no meeting ground between Gandhi and the Hindu right.
So I want to understand one thing, because in the section of the book where you deal with his assassination, you've gone into police records of the time and you talk about an intrepid reporter who actually leaves the site of the assassin, leaves Birla House and goes to the police station to
meet,
find...
Meet Godse, yeah.
Yes,
yeah, yeah.
Meet Godse. And Godse is unapologetic,
absolutely,
clearly about what he's done.
Yeah, yeah.
But he also says, I bowed to him because I respected his age and what he did before.
Right.
He made this the cornerstone of how India should go forward. You just said that gulf remains.
Yeah.
There's a lot of confusion over whether Godse was a member of the RSS or not, and who was behind his decision to assassinate Gandhi. You clearly say he's not in the RSS in this book.
At that time,
but
yeah,
he was at this time.
Yeah,
yes,
he was a member before. Yeah.
But he was also very close to Savarkar.
Correct.
So, was Godse acting alone?
See, we don't know. The evidence is inconclusive. But we do know that Savarkar was his mentor, was his hero. We also know that Savarkar absolutely detested Gandhi. And in Gandhi's own lifetime, the kind of abusive language he used about Gandhi and Kasturba. We also know that although Godse had left the RSS by the time of the assassination, the RSS was not displeased to see Gandhi go. You know, the speeches that I quote in my book, which are made by Golwalkar, no less than the head of the RSS, in Delhi in October, November 1947, where he says, you know, there is no place for Muslims in this country. And people like Gandhi should not be asking for Muslims to get equal rights in this country. There is no place for Muslims in this country. And those people who want Muslims to be equal citizens, we have the means to get them silenced. We will not do it, but we have the means to get them silenced. Now, this is more or less a veiled threat, right? And it's aimed at Gandhi and at Nehru. I mean, they're the two people, because after Gandhi, Nehru was the member of the national government who was most committed to equal rights for minorities. So that the RSS detested Gandhi is very, very clear in his lifetime, and particularly in his last months, and particularly for wanting to give equal rights to minorities. That was the basis of their hatred of Gandhi. And that's something they will have to acknowledge. I mean, today, in a few weeks, we will see the beginning of the 150th year anniversary celebrations of Gandhi's birth. And our Prime Minister, a lifelong RSS Pracharak, will try to say some sweet and anodyne things about Gandhi. But how does he reckon with how the RSS actually saw Gandhi on this very fundamental question? So we'll have to see.
In fact, you talk about that when you say, you know, how do we relate to or apply Gandhi's messages to the times that we live in today? Apart from the caste issue, this is a fundamental challenge that we're seeing in India today. You have the issue of cow slaughter that's come up. You have the entire move towards a right-wing fanatical Hindu ideology, Hindutva. And yet you have a government in power which subscribes to some of that, some of those beliefs, and adopt Gandhi, because you can't exactly get away from Gandhi, right? He's an international icon as far as India is concerned. So it's not just about reconciling him on the 2nd of October this year. It's an overall...
Absolutely.
How do you... How, I mean, what, no, I don't I know think, how to ask the question, actually.
No, I think, Maya, that's... to be fair, that's a question that not only Narendra Modi's government faces, but Manmohan Singh's government also faced. I mean, Congress governments of the past have betrayed Gandhi in many ways. I mean, Gandhi would have been appalled by the dynastic takeover of the Congress party, by corruption, by nepotism, by cronyism, you know. So, in that sense...
But he was not familiar with those struggles at his time, at the corruption and cronyism.
That's right. They hadn't come up. But certainly the dynastic culture of the Congress party he would have abhorred. I mean, none of his children were active in Congress politics. You know, they all went to jail, by the way. All four of his children were freedom fighters, went to jail. But none of them was given a position of responsibility in the Congress party. They were not made secretary or vice president or any of that. Right. So, but to go back to how the government of the day treats this anniversary, it's an interesting question. Because as you say, Narendra Modi recognizes that Gandhi was the one, after the Buddha, Gandhi was the one great global export that India had. Yeah. And he's much more recent. So how do you associate yourself with him? I mean, how do you reconcile your love, so-called admiration for Gandhi with the kind of hate speech that your party members make, including your chief ministers and party presidents, the kind of things they say about Muslims, right? Now, it'll be interesting to see, but... early on, Narendra Modi tried to reduce him to a pair of spectacles and Swachh Bharat. But obviously, he stands for much more. And once this anniversary celebrations come out, people will talk about other aspects of his work, Hindu-Muslim harmony, attacks, abolition of untouchability, the use of non-violence, you know, and so on and so forth, respect for all faiths. So, I think it'll be a hard task for the ruling party and the Prime Minister to basically incorporate Gandhi with any sincerity in their political worldview.
And before we conclude, you made a very interesting point right now, which is, you know, saying to be fair that it's not just this government, it's also the Congress that's failed Gandhi's teachings and philosophy. In fact, the day of his assassination, according to what you write, Patel had gone to meet him earlier that afternoon and had wanted to hand in his resignation because of differences rising with Nehru at the time.
Right,
and
right.
Nehru was supposed to meet him
afterwards,
after the prayer meeting in the evening. And Gandhi was looking for a way to bring these two, you know, almost as though they were errant children. And he was sort of ensuring that they would get the job done properly. And it was his task to do that. His assassination averted Patel's resignation. There's letters you quote between the two of them where they say, Bapu has died, now in spite of our own differences and crises, we have to come together and work.
Right.
What do you think would have happened had Gandhi not been assassinated that day? Had he lived, what would we have seen Indian politics shape?
Well, I think Patel was...
And the Congress, in fact.
I think Patel was determined to resign and he had not been getting along with Nehru for some months. And Nehru may have been relieved to see Patel go. Gandhi tried hard to reconcile them. He failed. And of course, he was very, very upset about it because he had seen Nehru and Patel as his main inheritors. And he says this very clearly from the 1930s, after I'm gone, Jawaharlal and Sardar will take forward my message. So, there had been a huge rift. The government might have collapsed. It might have come under. This is a time of great crisis and strain. It's the backdrop of partition. Refugees are pouring in, full of anger and animosity against the Muslims. The princely states haven't been integrated. A war has started with Pakistan over Kashmir. And at that stage, if the ship of state had not held together, who knows what would have happened. So arguably, Gandhi's martyrdom saved India. It saved Indian unity. It brought Patel and Nehru back together. They buried their differences. From 1948 till 1950, they worked devotedly and unitedly to bring about a democratic constitution, to unite the country territorially, to contain a communist insurgency, to contain the RSS threat from the Hindu right. So, I believe that his martyrdom saved India, saved Indian unity, and gave us maybe two decades of comparative social peace. I mean, it allowed us to frame a constitution, to bring about a democratic infrastructure, to unite the to bring the princely states on board.
To focus on institution building a little bit.
Absolutely. And through the 50s and 60s, Nehru built a series of many remarkable institutions, educational institutions, the election commission, the judiciary, multi-party democracy, all of which have kind of sustained us, even though there have been attacks on all these institutions. The basic institutions that undergird Indian unity and Indian democracy were built in the 1950s. And Gandhi's death, I think, allowed that breathing space. But it's hard to say if he had lived longer and Patel had left. You know, I think they, because the in 47, 48, around the time Gandhi was murdered, there was, people often forget this, and it's very important to recognize this, there was a threat from the extreme Hindu right, who wanted to purge and persecute all the Muslims that remained in India, right? That's well known and talked about, and I think has to be remembered today. But there was also a threat from the extreme communist left, who had launched an insurrection against the Indian state on the orders of Stalin and the Russian communist side. So the state was being pierced from the left and pinched from the right, and it may not have held had Nehru and Patel, who were the two major figures, you know,
had they fallen out completely,
gone their separate ways. Absolutely.
So there's perhaps as much as we wish that he had stayed alive and seen India through its formative years, perhaps we would have avoided the kind of tensions we had today. But the flip side is that it also ended up keeping these two people who could have pulled India apart.
And I think it also, beyond these two people, Maya, it shamed Hindus, because one of them had done it, you know, that they had killed their greatest hero, public figure, moral person of moral authority, the person who brought them freedom, who had led an utterly selfless and transparent life. So I think it shamed Hindus and radical Hindus as well.
Well, I think there's lessons there for everyone, politicians and ordinary citizens alike, as we struggle through what are clearly testing times,
I think,
in the stage of Indian democracy we're in. Thank you very much, Ramchandra Guha.
Thank you. Maya.
We could talk about this book for, I think, 3 days, given the size of it, but we'll have to leave it there. So thanks a lot.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.